All right, good evening. Welcome to the program. You're listening to The Soapbox here on WMPG. I'm your host, Eric Poulin. Thank you very much for joining me this evening. So tonight, we're talking about the minimum wage in and around Portland. I think it's a pertinent discussion in light of the national movement, Fight for 15. There's a movement brewing here in Portland for raising the minimum wage to $15 an hour as well. And I got at least two guests, perhaps one other on the way to the studio. Joe Baldacci, the brother of John Baldacci, former governor of Maine and city councilor, current city councilor on the Bangor City Council, is leading a movement to raise the minimum wage in Bangor. So welcome to the Soapbox, Joe.
Hey, thank you very much. I appreciate it, Eric. It's exciting to be here.
Glad to have you. And then also in the studio, we have Michael Hillard, professor of economics at University of Southern Maine and friend of the Soapbox, been on a couple times. Welcome back, Michael.
Thank you for having me, Eric.
Okay, Joe, can you tell us a little bit about what's going on in Bangor? How did this movement to raise the minimum wage begin, and sort of who's behind it? What's it about?
Well, I think, you know, obviously Portland Mayor Brennan initiated his proposal about a year ago, and I know it's taken some time, and I know it's going to probably be up for discussion and vote next month. You know, I think all of us are frustrated about the political situation. I would much prefer, you know, as many other Mainers would prefer, an increase at the federal level. I would prefer an increase at the state level. All of those are being blocked. So it's like the only way that things can at least try to be changed is to start at the local level. I think Mayor Brennan recognized that and has done a great job in terms of shepherding this proposal. And I think, you know, really it's time to raise the minimum wage. It hasn't been raised in 6 years. You know, there was a whole campaign last year where Democrats were beaten over the head about welfare. I mean, in some ways that whole debate is continuing. And I think it's important that we come back as progressives and say that it's time to reward work over welfare. It's time to raise people's wages. You can't have it both ways. It's time to give people a raise. And really the recovery that's occurred in the last 6 or 7 years, which is certainly welcome, has not really touched a lot of Mainers, a lot of Americans. Bangor is, you know, a relatively large city for the state of Maine, but we're up here about 2 hours north of you, and there's so many small towns. It's a rural, this part of Maine is very rural, and there is a real economic crisis in rural Maine that hasn't been touched by the recovery. We've lost so many manufacturing jobs. State government has done really nothing to promote economic development in eastern and northern Maine. And, you know, we got to start someplace. There's many things we need to do as a country, as a state. But the first thing is to really push wherever we can for an increase in the minimum wage.
Okay, you're listening to The Soapbox. That is Joe Baldacci, Bangor City Councilor. We're talking about the minimum wage, and if that is relevant to you, please call us up, 780-4909. If you're working for the minimum wage or near the minimum wage, or if you're a small business owner and would be impacted by raising the minimum wage, please join the conversation, 780-4909. Joe, so what are the numbers we're looking at here? What is the current minimum wage in Maine, and what are you looking to raise it to and by when?
Well, the current minimum wage in Maine is $7.50 an hour. It was last raised in the legislation was signed in 2007. The $7.50 went into effect in 2009. What I proposed was basically to raise it 75 cents a year for 3 consecutive years and then tie it to inflation, which would bring it up to $9.75 an hour by 2018, I think. And the revised Portland proposal actually comes in slightly lower than what I proposed in Bangor. But I'm sure, obviously, that was a product of much debate and compromise. But I am also supporting very heartily the Maine People's Alliance effort to raise it to $12 over the next 5 years and then tie it to inflation. It's been estimated that a raise of between, well, the President Obama's proposal of $10.10 an hour would benefit probably 100,000 Mainers. It's been estimated that the MPA's proposal of $12 over 5 years will probably benefit over 125,000 Mainers. But the more important thing is that the wages in general need to go up, and the minimum wage has always been a floor for wages in the general economy. So when we suppress the minimum wage, as it has been for several years, it not just hurts people at the lower end of the income, but it also hurts people above that, because when wages are frozen, basically, it discourages any kind of wage increases, or at least lessens them. So I'm working and working with many people, legislators. We're having a dinner Friday, June 26th in Lewiston, at the Lewiston Elks Lodge on Lisbon Street. And we're serving up some Michael Baldacci spaghetti, some homemade sauce and spaghetti. And we're also going to have many speakers about the minimum wage, both local and state, people talking about it. We hope to have, and I think there'll be some representatives from the Maine People's Alliance who will be there to gather signatures for the statewide referendum. So, and I did a town hall about a month and a half ago in Bangor. We had a great turnout. We didn't serve up spaghetti. We just had discussion, but it was a good turnout. And there's, you know, when you get beyond the politicians, okay, the vast majority of people, Republican, Democrat, Independent, they get this issue. They understand that the minimum wage needs to go up. They understand that it's not just an economic issue. In some ways, it's a moral issue. And the longer it gets frozen or suppressed, the more likely that we're going to have a larger increase at some point. So I think most Americans, most people in the state recognize that this needs to be done. I hope people in the Lewiston, Auburn area are able to turn out to the dinner. We've had some good press on it, and we've also had some help from a number of state legislators and local community activists. All the proceeds of the dinner, it's only $3 a person, but all the proceeds will benefit the New Beginnings Youth Shelter, which helps at-risk youth in Lewiston, Auburn, and their executive director will also be there. So we're trying to make this a community event in Lewiston, but also to talk about some important issues and to encourage people to get involved both locally and statewide.
All right, you're listening to the Soapbox on WMPG. That is Joe Baldacci talking about raising the minimum wage in Bangor and elsewhere in Maine. Join the conversation, 780-4909. Michael Hillard, professor of economics here at USM. Can you talk a little bit about what Joe was alluding to, this wage floor that the minimum wage sets, and maybe some of the downward pressure that has resulted from the collapse of unions in America that has sort of, has it driven wages down?
It certainly has. Let me just start with something that Councilor Baldacci was putting his finger on, which is that the problem with the way the minimum wage has been structured since it was first created at the federal level in the 1930s is that it's not adjusted for inflation. If you're a person working in a mall or in a restaurant or in a nursing home and you're at minimum wage or not very far above it, you see every year your rent go up. You often see your heating bills go up, electricity bills go up, phone bills. Basically the cost of living continues, even with moderate inflation, it continues to go up. And the problem with the minimum wage is that it gets set and then it's not adjusted for inflation automatically. Social Security benefits are, right? So, you know, we do take care of some people out there with a realistic, you know, policy that says that if your bills are going up, your payment should go up as well. For people who work low-wage jobs, of which there are much more of relatively than in the past, you're stuck in that predicament. So, you know, if the minimum wage had been adjusted for inflation over time at the federal level, we'd be about $10 an hour. And so, you know, I think that it's very important that these newer proposals are being indexed to inflation. It's virtually as important as getting the significant upfront increase. The other thing is just to realize, I think we have a caller here, so I can go back to my lecture in a moment.
All right. Azad, what's the name of the caller?
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, but the caller is John Hank, and he's on the Portland City Council. He's on the second phone line. John, are you there?
Yes, I am.
All right, John, welcome to the Soapbox. Join the conversation, talking about minimum wage.
Yeah, it's a good conversation. Hey, Joe.
Hey, John. Nice to talk to you.
I just called because we could actually get this done in Portland fairly quickly. And it's coming up, as Joe says. He seems to be tracking things pretty closely. We should be voting on it in July. It's possible to even be on the agenda before in the next council meeting here in June, but I think July is more reasonable time frame. And the proposal that I moved in the Finance Committee was for a 10-10 minimum wage, which would start in January, and then it would have a rise to 11 or 12, I forget my specific proposal, and after that be indexed for inflation. That concept is still alive and out there, even though a majority of the Finance Committee voted for something more modest.
John, this is Michael Hillard. Once it gets into the full city council, is there a chance for some of that to get maybe fixed in a better way?
Yes. I think we have the real possibility of a majority of five councilors voting for at least an initial 10-10 minimum wage.
That's great, John. That's great.
And what can citizens who are here in Portland do to help that process?
Obviously, you need to call the city councilors.
Can you find who your city councilor is on the city website?
Yeah, it should work fairly well.
Okay.
How many members of the council are there?
There are 9 members.
Okay, and how many are on the finance committee?
We only had 3 vote that day.
Okay.
So... 2 of them, Councillor Mavidonis and Councillor Dusan, did vote for an increase in the minimum wage, but more modest than what I was pushing for. And I don't know whether they're still open to something more ambitious, but I actually think it's the other council members that need to be perhaps the greater focus. The mayor is in favor of the more ambitious plan, and that's Mike Brennan. People can thank him for all he's done, but I don't think he needs to be pushed. So that leaves a few other councillors, Councillor Costa, Councillor Suslovic.
John, can I ask you where the number 10-10 came from? Is that from Obama's push?
It was actually, not only is it Obama's push, but it was also came out of the recommendation of the task force that met in Portland, although it was the second tier of that recommendation. The reason why I moved that it be our starting point was because it's taken us a year, so let's skip the first tier and start with the second tier.
John, this is Joe. What is the status of the Green Party's referendum drive? Is that going forward as well?
As far as I know, it's going forward.
And how would that
affect? They were out in the at the farmers market on Saturday, so they're at it.
Yeah, they're out there.
How would that affect these proposals, or would it?
Presumably, that would go on top. Although it gets a little complicated because I believe the city council can go ahead and adopt and maybe even modify a citizen petition once it has the signatures or at least put a competing measure on the ballot. I don't know whether that's anything that we would want to do. I would like us to pass something which raises the minimum wage significantly, and then we'll have a discussion over whether or not a higher minimum wage has more benefits or perhaps more costs or problems.
I think
if we went to $15 an hour, we would that would be unusual for a city our size.
Right.
Well, I think that's encouraging to hear. I mean, you know, tying into inflation is definitely a great step in the right direction. I think the work that all of you guys are doing is fantastic. But, you know, in reality, if the wages had kept up with production in America, it would be much, much higher than $10. It would be closer to between 15 or 20.
That's if it had kept up with inflation. I think it would be upwards of 20.
Mm-hmm.
If it had kept up by other metrics, like the relationship between the highest paid and the lowest paid people, it would be even higher.
Right.
I'm sorry to interject with a little constructive criticism. if the minimum wage had kept pace with inflation over the last 35 years, we'd be around $10 an hour. $10
just $10.
Yeah, real. That's significant.
So, but what about productivity though? Right, because productivity has gone up so much.
So yeah, I mean, right. The basic thing is, I teach economics. I do this in my first class every semester. Is that I show what's happened to the median wage over the last 35 years. Which is that it's down 10 or 15% from where it was. And then you look at GDP per person or productivity per worker, and that's roughly doubled. So, we have had a situation that everybody's been talking about since Occupy, which is that we generate new wealth in this country, and almost nobody who's producing it sees it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know... I think the thing that people who've been on this issue for a long time, and I have to give an old organization, I used to be part of Maine Center for Economic Policy, some credit for this, is to point out that the discussion really should be about what a livable wage is, and how can we have an economy that does that. And, you know, some of the problems is that, you know, in Maine, if you look at the typical job for somebody who doesn't have a college education, it used to be working in a paper mill or maybe even a textile mill. And those jobs have gone. That's where the unionized jobs were that took what had once been low wage jobs and made them into middle class jobs. And then the growth has been in the Walmarts, frankly, you know, and to a lesser extent, and it's kind of a helpful thing, some of the new food culture in restaurants. But, you know, those are places where unions have not been welcome. The environment legally in this country for 35 years has essentially made it almost impossible to join a union, even though their law is protecting it. So unionization has dropped off to nothing. And so, you know, that's what this new, you know, fight for 15 and all the push in Maine and elsewhere to raise the minimum wage, it's an obvious place to start.
Mm-hmm.
To deal with this broader inequality problem. Everybody who, you know, looks at it realistically says we need a lot more.
Yeah.
We need healthcare to be a sure thing. We need unemployment insurance and training to be much better. We need a whole host of things. But minimum wage is the best place to start because that's where people are feeling the most hurt. And the cause is just very just because basically people who are working at minimum wage or near it have been taking a wage cut every year because of inflation.
You're right. It helps spur, though, a broader discussion about middle-class economics in general in terms mm-hmm. of all those issues that need to be addressed, not just the minimum wage.
And especially that it's a societal issue and not an individual issue. It's a
right.
societal issue that we have a moral responsibility that people who work should not be poor.
Well, and the reason I was asking about the numbers is because I had heard, and Michael, I'm hoping you might be able to correct me if I'm wrong, but that 10-10 number that the Obama administration picked wasn't out of thin air. It's based on the CPI, I think. To help me with these economic terms.
Yeah, no. The basic thing is that's an effort to recoup what's been lost to inflation.
Well, I had heard that it was sort of somewhat cynical in the sense that it was just barely above the poverty line. But of course, the poverty line is based on an outdated
market basket?
Well, yeah, that's a related discussion. People who are, you know, all policymakers, and Joe and John, I'm sure you're familiar with this, all policymakers who are talking about whether it's healthcare or other things talk about, you know, we're going to take care of people to 125% or 175% of the poverty level, because the poverty level is way below what people can live on. That's why the livable wage concept is really relevant. Yeah, they came up with this short-run sort of survival food budget in 1955. And that was when people spent a third of their income on food. And then they said, okay, well, let's take this budget. How much does it cost? Multiply times three. People now spend only about 12% of their budget on food. So if we took that budget and multiplied by eight, we'd be up at something like $15 an hour. Yeah. So the, you know, $15 to $20 an hour full time would be what it would take to be at the poverty level. But the poverty level is set far too low to really indicate, you know, where the problem of poverty starts and ends. It starts far higher than the poverty level. Poverty level is really a poor measure, so to speak.
Joe, are you hearing from small business owners in Bangor who are pushing back against this? Are they threatening to, or are they concerned about needing to lose jobs or close?
I've gotten some pushback. I was going to ask John the same question about the Poulin experience, about the pushback from the business community. Yeah, there's a number. I have gotten pushback, but I've also gotten a number of small business people who understand, you know, that in order to retain workers, I mean, particularly if Poulin, one of the points I tried to make a couple months ago was that Poulin raises the minimum wage, it puts increased pressure on Bangor to also up or have a citywide minimum wage, because we don't want all young people in northern Maine to have to want to come to Portland's a great city. I have a number of relatives
there. Some of your best friends are from Poulin.
Some of my best friends are in Poulin, but and I went to law school there. But I'm just saying that we're going to have increased pressure to keep and attract younger workers if Poulin raises the minimum wage, which I think will be a good thing. I think having that kind of competition is a good thing, because there's an upward pressure on wages. Now, I don't know how many jobs are in the city of Poulin proper. In the city of Bangor, Bangor represents about 3% of the state's population, but we have 6% of the state's workforce. So there are 35,000 actual jobs within the city proper of Bangor. So we'd be talking, you know, a minimum wage increase and the big the opponents of the minimum wage increases first say it's not going to help anybody. It's so few workers. And then, but they're still so vehemently against it. So it's hard to buy that argument. But the percentages out of 35,000 workers in Bangor, probably a couple thousand at least would benefit from a minimum wage increase, which would be the people we'd want to help.
And you can double that for people who are just above the minimum wage, whose businesses would have to adjust their wages as well. There's that upward ripple effect that happens for a much larger group.
Michael, can I ask you this too? Is part of the challenge of doing this piecemeal sort of city by city, what happens to the businesses who say, well, I'm just going to go to South Portland, or I'm just going to go outside of Bangor? Have any studies been done on the, you know, an exodus of business?
Well, you know, there's been a ton of research for decades around this idea that businesses pick up and leave over incremental changes in taxes or wages. It's just not a reality. If you've established a business, you have a long-term lease, you have foot traffic or whatever, you're not going to go to Wyndham when your business is really built around Poulin. That's just a red herring. I mean, people come up with those arguments. They say the same thing about taxes. Mm-hmm. It's just not an accurate thing. The other thing to remember is that, look, you know, the businesses that are generally effective and are not chains in Subway or fast food or Walmart or whatever are paying their workers more. It's the people who work at those big chains, that are being paid the least. And if you increase the minimum wage, I mean, Walmart's not going to get up and flee. And it gives those workers more of an income, which means it's better for local business. And I've talked to local business people here in Portland who say, wow, you know, if the folks working at Olive Garden are making $10, $11, $12 an hour, they're going to be able to come and buy things at my business. Mm-hmm. So you got to look at the other side of the coin, that it is good for business because it's where spending power comes from.
Mm-hmm. John, real quick, what has the pushback been like in Portland? Are you still there?
Yeah, there is. You know, the one problem we have now, I attribute it to going back to the Reagan years, is that a certain part of a segment of society, and even in Portland, is really against government doing anything like this. Hmm. So you almost have to count on that percentage being a chorus against no matter what the proposal is, because they are simply against government setting standards and making requirements. If you eliminate, you know, if you not don't count them because their position never changes, it's relatively small in Portland, those people who've said that they think it's really going to hurt their business, but there are some. Then we do have the kinds of business owners who say this would be good for precisely the reasons Michael was saying. It's Michael, right?
Yep. Yes.
Bill Duggan owns Videoport. He says if we raise the minimum wage in Portland, the people getting it are my customers.
Right. Mm.
This is precisely the people I want walking around with a little bit more money in their pocket. Mm.
Can I add one little piece to this? This is a pitch for another show with, I think, the same group of people, because I especially really would like to hear what Joe Baldacci would have to say about this. I think one of the biggest problems that we've had is the idea that some of our politicians, especially our governor, keeps harping on, which is that welfare is the problem. Mm. It's such a great vehicle for stigmatizing government, for reinforcing that kind of Reagan idea that, you know, government is terrible and just messes things up. And I think that we have a political problem in this state, whereas some people are progressively looking at things like raising the minimum wage. We have a governor that just keeps trying to sell to as many people as possible the idea that there's hundreds of thousands of people who are cheating the system.
Right.
Joe, I don't know what you'd have to say about that, but I think that's the biggest problem we're facing right now.
Yeah, you know, this governor appeals to the lowest common denominator, and there's so many sad facets of the last 4 years. But the last, you know, his McCarthyistic attitude and his whole attack on the poor, and you know, I consider myself a moderate to liberal Democrat, but you know, this guy is so far out of the mainstream that it's sad. You know, as a city councilor, I'm sure John, you know, we both
just 10 more seconds there, Joe. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay, as a city councilor and as a former mayor, you know, I'm familiar with the general assistance issue. I know you guys have a general assistance issue. We're the two cities, probably with Lewiston, who are most affected by the whole general assistance issue. We are paying, the general assistance budget is now becoming a quasi-welfare budget because of all the people that have been thrown off. The cuts to general assistance are now forcing property taxpayers in Bangor and in Portland to pay such an enormous share of what should be a state responsibility.
Okay, Joe. Well, I'm sorry. We're going to have to end it there. But Joe Baldacci, city councilor in Bangor, thank you very much for being here. John Hink, city councilor in Portland, thanks for calling in.
Nice show. Thank you.
And Michael Hillard, professor of economics here at USM, thank you very much for being here.
Always a pleasure. Keep up the fight.
Thanks. And thank you for tuning in here on the Soapbox on WMPG. Tune in next week. I'll have Salvatore Babones, the author of 16 for 16, A Progressive Agenda for a Better America, coming in to talk about just that. So thanks for tuning in. Stick around for Dog's Dinner with Pope coming up next on WMPG. Thank you to Azad for engineering. Whenever it's possible, but with a little grain of salt. Tell me who calls that living with no gas?
100 years. That's why I say that.